You're listening to the audio production of Frederick by Frederick Ndabaramiye and Amy Parker, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Barry Scott.
Foreword. When I first met Frederick, he was still just a kid at the Imbabazi orphanage in Rwanda. I was immediately awestruck by the beaming smile of this young man who had been through so much, who had lost his hands to a group of ruthless murderers. I wondered how a kid could have suffered so much and yet still be smiling, still be filled with such a contagious hope. And then the other question hit. How in the world is he sitting there painting a landscape with no hands? During his first trip to the United States, I watched him adapt quickly to a world that before stepping off that plane, he had never even fathomed. A world with car washes, five-lane roads, and a set of prosthetic hands just for him. He blew us all away with his abilities, and he's been doing it ever since. When he headed back to Rwanda with those new hands, I thought, our work is done here. Frederick's story has a happy ending. But then, when I went back to see him in Rwanda, there he was, teaching a group of disabled people how to play volleyball with no hands. So, we did a little filming and closed that storybook with another unbelievable happy ending. But then I went back again, and there he was, in a two-room building, teaching the disabled and beggars how to paint and speak English. That moment was a turning point for me. That's when this kid truly took hold of my heart. That's when I learned to never underestimate Frederick Ndabaramiye, that no matter what he's doing, he's only getting started. Over the years, Frederick and I have grown to be good friends. I see him at least once a year now, at the Rwandan Fete in Columbus, or at his home in Rwanda. But no matter how often I see him, one thing never changes. My absolute astonishment at his abilities. Whatever you throw at him, he'll catch it. And he'll do so with a smile. A few years ago, Pastor Tom Mullins invited Frederick to speak at Christ Fellowship Church in Palm Beach Gardens, Florida. It's a huge church with about 40,000 attendees over the course of a weekend, including several big celebrities, and Frederick spoke at their services. As that young man delivered his story to the church, the entire congregation was completely mesmerized. No one moved, no one coughed, no one shuffled in their seats. You could have heard a pin drop. Afterward, Pastor Mullins came to me and said, "Jack, I started this church 20 years ago, and I've never had this kind of response from anyone who's been here." At the Columbus Zoo, we've adopted a mission and a method to touch the heart to teach the mind. We know that to initiate change and generate awareness as advocates for the animal kingdom, we have to begin by touching the hearts of humans. Frederick unknowingly takes this same approach, and in doing so, has initiated great change in his town in Rwanda, and quite literally around the world. The Lord has to be with him for him to do all that he does. When he came to hang a prosthetics to get his new fingers, they were all baffled by his ability to instantly put the prosthetics to work. And do you know, the first thing he told them he wanted to use the fingers for? To build himself a house, of course. The entire team just sat in awe, watching this young man as he operated those fingers with the agility and skill it takes most people months and years to learn. I've tried myself to see how long I could go without my hands, trying to do what Frederick does day in and day out. I tried to get dressed, brush my teeth, and fasten my belt without the help of my hands. And I'll tell you, after about 30 minutes, I gave up. One time, while Frederick was staying with my wife, Susie, and me, I was loading the car with suitcases when I heard Sue scream, "Stop, Frederick! Get off!" I looked up to see him riding down the road on my bicycle. He had seen it in the garage and decided to go for a ride. We hadn't even noticed, and he was doing just fine, riding it as well as she or I would. But it scared Susie to see him riding off down the road, steering a bicycle with no hands. She and I had never seen anything so incredible. Another time, he was staying with us in Columbus, and we were getting ready to go to an event. We were running a little late, and he came out and asked Susie, "Will you help me button these last two buttons?" I just looked at him, my mouth hung open, and I finally asked, "Well, how the heck did you get the other four buttoned?" Frederick just laughed, that big laugh, as he always does, like a magician who never tells his tricks. "So, let me tell you, whatever this magician has up his sleeve, you want to see it. Whatever he has to say, you want to hear it. Whatever you can learn from his life, you don't ever want to forget it. Because of Frederick, I look at life differently. I thank God for my health and the things I can do, and I ask him to help me be more like Frederick and face the things I think I can't do. When I get discouraged, I tell myself, if Frederick can do this, I can too. Frederick has shown me, as he's shown everyone privileged to know him, that everything is possible if you have a little faith. Today, you become one of the privileged. Today, you meet Frederick Jack Hanna, Director Emeritus of the Columbus Zoo, host of Jack Hanna's Into the Wild and Jack Hanna's Wild Countdown. Prologue. Countless historical and political accounts have been written about the Rwandan genocide. This is not one of them. I observed as a child, watching with confusion and defenseless acceptance as merciless killing swept through my country, my neighborhood, my family. I am simply a Rwandan, one of millions with harrowing stories to tell. More than that, I am a survivor, one whose tragedy has propelled me into a man I could have never been otherwise. Whatever the circumstances, I believe, I know, survival makes us stronger. Survival makes us smarter. Survival provides a unique fuel for our passion for life. I was only 11 when the genocide earthquaked my foundations of security and hope. The event and its aftershocks would leave me forever changed, mentally, spiritually, emotionally, and perhaps most obviously, physically. Yet, in a strange way, in those mysterious ways known only by our God, those perpetrators of the genocide would leave me with an iron will and an undeniable purpose. But in order to gain those gifts, I would first have to journey to the brink of death and back again, and again. My adherence to my faith would cost me my hands. But just as my faith drove me to my troubles, my faith would lead me out again. And on the other side, I would realize a clearer, bolder picture of who God wanted me to be. While being newly equipped with the passion, hope, and faith needed to paint that picture, it was only after losing my hands that I was finally able to grasp God's purpose for my life, to strip the world of its excuses and replace them with hope and inspiration, to fulfill the dreams God has placed in the hearts of His people. In Rwanda, we've begun that work of rebuilding hope in very tangible ways, but I know there's more. I know this story isn't just for me. It isn't just for Rwanda. I know this story is for everyone, because now I know that in the end, we are all broken, and we are all searching for hope. If your eyes have been darkened by hate or guilt or despair, if forgiveness is a faraway, unnavigable utopia, if you're seeking hope where hopelessness abounds, I have a story for you. It's a story with unfathomable depths of grief and insurmountable heights of hope. But it's a true story. It's my story. And I hope that, in some small way, it can be a turning point for your own. Lord, I have called daily upon you. I have stretched out my hands to you. Will you work wonders for the dead? Shall the dead arise and praise you? Shall your loving kindness be declared in the grave, or your faithfulness in the place of destruction? Psalms chapter 88, verses 9 through 11. Chapter 1, New Beginnings. If you feel that the world is sometimes a cold place, that the human spirit cannot beat back despair, think of Frederick Ndabaramiye. Think of him and smile. Charlie Gibson. You ready? The guy spoke to me as he adjusted the height on his tripod. I had never seen a camera so big. Another person was pulling a chair a few centimeters to the left. Someone else repositioned the traditional African mask, the only object relatively familiar to me, that sat in Charlene's living room. A light as bright as the African sun shined on the man across from me. Did he say his name was Charlie? Frederick. Charlene kneeled down in front of me. Are you okay? Are you ready to start? I had a basic understanding of English, but my ability to speak the language was much less developed. Even so, I knew the answer to both of her questions, no and no. A few weeks ago, I had boarded a huge, mysterious vehicle I had never seen before and trusted it to carry me through the air to the other side of the world, to a place I knew very little about. I was overwhelmed before I even boarded the airplane. I had never been to Kigali, Rwanda's capital city, where we would be flying out from. But even at nighttime, I could tell that it was larger than any town I'd ever seen. As we drove to the airport, an infinite field of lights rose up all around me. I could only imagine how big it looked in the daytime. The airport was monstrously large and full of people, a lot of them speaking English and other languages I didn't understand. Upstairs in the terminal, glass cases held cigars and candies and liquors and sodas in endless varieties. Stern-faced, uniformed men behind glass walls asked me all kinds of questions about where I was going and what I was doing there. They peered at my passport before waving me through to go meet my fate on that big white plane. How long will it take to get there? I asked Tony, my translator, at least 100 times. He would answer and pull out a map to show me where we were now and where we were going. But it did little to calm my anxiety. Have you ever been inside an airplane before? Yes, he smiled at me, anticipating my next question. What does it look like? He described rows of seats and windows with a driver in the front. Something that sounded like a really, really big bus. Except for the part where it flew in the air. I couldn't quite wrap my mind around the image, though, until we climbed aboard. Tony found our seats and let me slide in first by the window, where I could see that ground was already several meters below us. I didn't sleep all night. I stared out that window the entire time, watching the ground as it fell out from under us, while an intense pressure pushed me back in my seat. And I didn't stop watching until the ground rose back up to hold the plane so that I could step out onto solid ground. After a whole night and day of travel, I exited the airplane through a long tunnel. At the end of that tunnel, I discovered a dizzying world beyond anything I'd ever imagined, even after all the stories I had heard about America. There were lights, so many lights, and voices yelling over loudspeakers in words I didn't understand. There were 1,000 white people. I had never seen so many before, even though I knew they wouldn't really use my head as alligator bait, as I had been warned as a child. I was still fearful at the sight of them. How would I speak to them? Would they even care what I had to say? I'll be right here to help you the whole time, Tony reassured me, sensing my increased anxiety. After we picked up our bags, we made our way to the exit to find a car. Standing there was a lady holding up a sign that said, Frederick. When she saw me, she started waving and calling, Frederick! Frederick! I knew a handful of people from the United States, but she wasn't one of them. I walked closer and asked her, How do you know me? Charlene Gendry gave me a picture of you, she explained. My name is Margaret. I'm going to be your driver, she grinned. I had never seen a lady drive a car before. In Rwanda today, you sometimes see women driving, but back then, it seemed so strange to me. However, this trip had already been an adventure of many firsts, so I followed her to the car. As we loaded our luggage into Margaret's car, Tony announced, Now we're getting close. We drove away from all of the people in the airport terminal, only to see just as many cars on the wide, flat road. There was row after row of very tall houses. No one at all was walking on the roads until we got to a smaller road. But even then, there were only a few people running and riding bicycles. No one was carrying goods on their heads to or from the market. I saw no burlap bags of charcoal, no baskets of avocados or bananas. Yet everyone seemed to be in a focused hurry to go somewhere. I had a hard time falling asleep that night, my first night in America. That was probably due, in part, to the television being on all night. I sat there in a dizzy daze, watching the flickering images of white people talking and dancing and leisurely reading books. I tried to translate the fast, fluent conversations, and I swayed and danced to the music. It was all so surreal. I was in America. After I had settled into Charlene's house, which felt more like a hotel, I tried to follow all of the advice and tips I had been given about travel to this new world, even down to the food. Back at the orphanage, a lady from Canada had visited and told me that Americans ate a lot of fast food, that they had hamburgers and hot dogs everywhere. However, when we went to one restaurant, a place where a guy in a tall white hat chopped and cooked our food on the sizzling table in front of us, I tried to order a hamburger, and I was promptly told that they didn't even have it on the menu. But I was quite pleased to discover that they had rice and mixed vegetables instead. To top it off, the guy even made a volcano out of onions with real smoke coming out of it. That place helped me to make me feel a bit more at home. When I finally did get to try a hamburger, I decided then that I would just stick to the rice and vegetables. But I discovered I really liked the French fries. And chicken. Chicken was my favorite. Toward the end of my stay in the U.S., I was able to go visit my friend David Jeranek in New York. David was a photographer whom I had met at the Imbabazi orphanage in Rwanda. When he heard that I was coming to the States, he arranged for me to come to his house and meet his family. New York City was huge, much bigger than Kigali. There were people everywhere, on foot and in cars, and there were the tallest houses, taller than anything I had ever imagined. One day, while I was there, David and his wife, Cricket, took me to see a parade. I had never seen anything like it before. There were so many people, even more than before, crowded into the streets. But the oddest thing of all were these big, colorful plastic people floating in the air. They had ropes tied to them that ran down to men and women standing on the ground, guiding the floating people down the street. David, Cricket, and I were watching the parade when I became mesmerized by one of the tall houses. I just stood there looking up, trying to see the top, thinking about the people inside, and imagining what they were doing, what their houses looked like from inside. After a few moments, I looked back to David, but he was gone. I spun around. Cricket was gone, too. No one looked familiar, and I had absolutely no idea where I was. I didn't have a phone number or an address, nothing. I walked quickly through the streets, watching in all directions, trying to remember what color everyone was wearing. Then from out of nowhere, I heard someone calling my name. Frederick! I turned, and there stood Cricket. I was never so relieved to see a familiar face. From then on, I insisted that I stand in the middle of the group, and I never fell behind again. The food in New York was unbelievable. Every time I ordered a meal, they brought me enough for five people. And then they kept asking me if I wanted more. A guy in one restaurant came by and asked me if I wanted some more iced tea. Oya, I answered, which means no in Rwanda. But he brought me more tea anyway. At the end of the meal, when we had a moment, I asked him playfully, "So why did you bring me more tea when I said I didn't want any?" Confused, he answered, "But you said yes." I said, "Oya, that means no back home in Rwanda." He laughed. "Well, in America, oh yeah means yes." I had no idea. After that, I just learned to say no thank you. I experienced so many new things during that trip to New York. The first time I stepped inside a train, I didn't know what was going to happen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.